Hello, I'm Richard Ager. Welcome to New Hampshire Outlook. New Hampshire is known for having one of the lowest crime rates in the country, but we are also earning a reputation for having one of the fastest growing prison populations. This year, a bipartisan coalition of lawmakers and service organizations worked to change that. The result is the Justice Reinvestment Act, which has just become law.
Even though we are the safest state, and our crime rate has remained low and stable for the past decade, New Hampshire's prison population has increased by over 25% in that same 10-year period. Spending on corrections in the same period nearly doubled from $50 million to $100 million. More than half of the state's prison admissions in 2009 were people whose probation or parole supervision was revoked. And that's unacceptable. To make New Hampshire safer, we have to do more to ensure that our released offenders become productive members of our society, do not commit new crimes, and do not return to prison. Spending our tax dollars to continue to expand prison capacity will not accomplish those goals and will not make our state safer. That's why we need to redirect our efforts.
The new law calls for increased supervision of released prisoners, immediate sanctions for parole violations, truth in sentencing by requiring serving 100% of the minimum sentence, and reinvesting of savings in treatment programs for high-risk parolees and probationers. The intent is to reduce repeat offenders, save taxpayer money, and improve public safety.
The thing that we have to remember is that we're talking about people. We're talking about somebody's mother, brother, sister, father, or there, but for the grace of God, go you or I, who might end up in prison or jail. So this is a very important piece of legislation, not only to protect public safety, but also to provide services for all of us who may or may not be recipients of that. So what New Hampshire has done is a model. You all have set the standard.
Okay, this bill is now law in the state of New Hampshire.
And joining me in room 100 of the State House in Concord, we have William Wrenn, who is the Commissioner of the New Hampshire Department of Corrections, Chris Kuntz, a former inmate at the state prison in Concord, who is nearing the completion of his parole, and John Broderick, Chief Justice of the New Hampshire Supreme Court. Gentlemen, thank you all for joining us.
Nice to be with you, Richard.
You know, Chris, I'd like to start with you because back in 2003, just as a little background, you were sentenced to 4 to 10 years for assault. First part of your sentence was over, you went to the minimum security, and then after that, released to a halfway house. What was that day like when you re-entered, at least partially, society?
Well, when I went to the, I remember when I went to the minimum security unit, the prison, when I was inside the prison kind of opened up their doors. They gave me trash bags to fill my stuff with. And then they opened up the front doors and they said, go down that way. And I looked up and there was two guards up there in the towers and there was guns in their hands and I was pretty scared. And then I went out to the halfway house and that was real scary. The only time I'd been to Concord was to go to the prison. But they gave me a piece of paper and they gave me some ideas of where I can find a job and where to go. But there was a catch to it. I had to get a signature from the employer. And that was the shutting door of the whole thing. You know, I knew I wasn't going to get a job at that point. But, I mean, you asked how it was. It was scary, you know. Without a doubt, it was scary.
You feel prepared, or did you feel that you had been prepared, or that the people had worked with you in the prison to prepare you for that day?
No. To be honest with you, no, I don't. The focus on me when I was in the prison was to work on my anger management, which they did, and to work on my drug and alcohol substance abuse, which they did. And but to prepare me to get out to the real world and to deal with society, not at all.
Is any of this a surprise, either of you?
Well, it's no surprise to me, Richard, because that's the way our system has been for a long time. The prison focused on rehabilitation and dealing with some of the issues that person has brought with them into the prison, whether it be substance abuse or lack of education or whatever the issues are, what we call the drivers of the behavior. It might have been mental illness. Whatever it is, we work on that. And we've tried to do a very good job at doing that. But there was never a look at the transition of that person from the prison back out into the community again.
which means more than half of the admissions to prisons over the last 10 years has actually been people who were in there before.
And that's the problem. And when we look at our recidivism rates and we really start to analyze what is bringing people back to the prisons, we've come to find out it was in many cases our lack of preparation of that individual to transition back into the community and then to provide that safety net in the community, those additional services in the community that are so needed today. We could do a great job inside the prison, but unless we have services out in the community to continue with helping that individual, there's a certain amount that are going to fail and are going to come right back into the system.
And of course, this has its impact on the courts because you see these guys again.
More than half the inmates at the state prison on any given day are there because they violated parole or probation. They stay an average of 9 months. It's about $35,000 a year. But more importantly, it's people who wanted to get out with their life, many of them, but maybe for the reasons Chris was alluding to, they can't find a job, or they still have a substance issue, or they may have a mental health problem. And so we need to deal with it effectively when they leave. And if we don't, we see them back in the jails and prisons, but we see them in the courthouses. And oftentimes, the folks who come back on probation or parole violation come back for technical violations, not always a new crime. And so I think what the commission's been trying to do, and the legislature and the governor, is to sift more finely, not to be soft on crime. This isn't about that. It's about being smart on crime, about helping people reconnect to a successful life. And I'm not sure giving someone like Chris, who seems like a bright young man, a list of places to go with a felony attached to your ankle is the best way to move on with life. We can do better than that.
Well, and of course you did, but perhaps in spite of rather than because of assistance that was given you.
I lucked, when I was out there, I lucked out actually. I had a friend who was in the halfway house with me, and it just so happened that the job that he was at, another gentleman was leaving there, and he put my name to his supervisor, and the supervisor put his hand out and gave me a job.
Well, Chris, at any time were you concerned about ending up back in prison following a string of rejections?
Yeah, the concern definitely crossed my mind. There's been gentlemen out in the halfway house who had not found a job for months. The longest person out there probably 2 months without finding a job. The concern definitely crossed my mind without a doubt. After 2 weeks went by and I still didn't find a job, the self-doubt kicks in and...
So what kind of services would you have hoped for that you simply didn't find?
Maybe just like classes that, I wouldn't say classes, maybe just the sessions that were with dealing with people and, how to present yourself to an employee that you want to get a job from and, kind of guidelines like that.
Well, I know both of you worked on this act as it was coming to fruition. How much of that do you think we're going to see in an era of, as we know, diminishing budgets? There's just been a call for a 5% cut, in next year's budgets.
Well, we actually have three initiatives going at this point in time. One being the Justice Reinvestment Act, which was just signed into law by Governor Lynch, which is going to provide case management and late act services out in our community, but also is going to adjust the law to allow us to do certain things, get people out into the community within a reasonable amount of time, especially those nonviolent offenders. It's going to give our probation parole officers some necessary tools to assist the individuals that are out on parole and on probation. And the other initiatives we have going, our Community Corrections Division, which is our newly expanded Community Corrections Division, which will be in charge of our case management system and our late act services out in the community. And we also received the Second Chance Act grant, which is a demonstration grant.
That's federal money.
Merrimack County, it's federal money, mm-hmm. Which is going to provide not only case management and late act services in Merrimack County, but also we'll have job services, job placement services, and counseling for those individuals that will be seeking a job. So if Chris were to go out at that point in time, he'd have somebody working with him to find him a job.
Well, you know, I asked because we spoke to some parole officers during an earlier on in the process of this act, and some of them said things like, you know, they're dealing with a caseload of 150 in a month, and that they're working overtime and on weekends simply to catch up on paperwork for their jobs, which they're not getting any pay for, and that more for less is always what's being expected of them. And I'm wondering, you know, I didn't see this in the bill itself, any ironclad guarantees of money, and we know how state budgets go.
The theory, Richard, I think it's very consistent with declining state budgets in this sense. Nationally, over the last 30 years, the United States spends $52 billion currently on corrections. 30 years ago, we spent about $20 billion in corrections. We cannot build ourselves out of this problem. Doing nothing is going to make the declining budgets crippling on corrections. What the commission is trying to do, and the legislature and the governor's office, is to make sure that we don't keep rising the cost of the jails and prisons. So if we're smarter about it, if we provide services so they don't come back, remember what I said earlier, half the inmates on any given day at the state prison are there because they violated parole and probation. I think another thing they're trying to do, of course, is to say, who are the most high-risk possibilities of the people we released? Let's put more of our probation parole time on them and less on those who might succeed on their own.
Well, as we know, a lot of legislators are really looking at this to help save money as well. And I'm wondering, you've both been through the bureaucratic money battles before. Are you convinced that savings would in fact go to what the at this time is the stated or intended purpose?
Well, I think it's probably going to be one of our biggest challenges in the future, especially in economies like we're in right now. But in order to make this work, you have to have money that's reinvested back into the community. And that's why in the intent of this law, we stated that there has to be a reinvestment back into the community of some portion of the savings that we may realize as a result of this law.
If they don't reinvest, this won't work.
Ultimately. It won't work.
To give you a sense of proportion, just in our state, the commission's budget, which is not enough given the current model on the ground, hopefully it will be with the revisions, the commission's budget is about $104 million, $108 million for the state prison. That's it. The budget for the entire court system, the third branch of government, is $76 million. We spend almost 50% more on the state prison than we spend on the judicial branch. And it's not enough given the current model. So what the commission is interested in doing is being smarter about crime. I want to reemphasize, it's not soft on crime. It's allowing people like Chris to get back to life. 95% of the people in the state prison are coming out. The average stay there is 2 to 4 years. So if we're not smarter about how do we help people like Chris, who wants to get his life going, to do that, we're going to get them back. We're going to pay for the failures. It's not cheap.
Well, you know, Chris, back to your case, because one of the things I found most impressive when I spoke with you is that you're now just, what, about a year or so away from the first stage of your electrician's license, is that
yep.
right?
Yep.
Which is, that's amazing for anybody to, you know, to earn those, because it's a lot of work. Are there others that you met while in prison and in transitioning out who perhaps have fallen behind because they weren't able to get the same breaks that you got?
I would say a lot of the inmates that came back are, the biggest reason that they came back were that the people that I to personally talk to were because of money. They would get involved in drug sales, robberies, and I mean, people don't have money because they don't have jobs, you know. There's that fine line again, do they want a job or do they want to just take the easy way out, you know? But such as the Job Corps situation you were talking about, the setup. If I had that going out to the halfway house, that would be great, you know.
Well, how did you manage to get so far on your progress towards electricians? Because of course you do have to pay for training.
Right. Well, when I got out of the halfway house, I went home and a friend of mine called me up and I had asked him if he could to ask his employee if I could get a job, and he works for an electrical company. And he called me up and he said, yeah, we're looking for somebody. He said he'd give you the opportunity, and I started working for him. He picked me up every day. I didn't have my license. I didn't know anything. to begin with electricity, or how this whole process works. So he said, I need to start school. So I signed up for school, and it got even better. By my employee said, well, yeah, if you stick with us, we'll pay for your schooling. So I said, sweet, that's a good deal.
What was different about this employer that made him or her willing to get you, to stick with you, and others won't even look at an application if it's got, you know, a former felon?
Well, it just so happened that he was a God person. He goes to church, and not only that, he was in prison himself. He was in the federal system, so he stuck his hand out and gave me a chance. And you know, the only way I could thank him enough was to just be a hard worker and continue to be a hard worker. And I did that. He paid for my schooling. He paid for the first 2 years of my schooling, and unfortunately, things slowed down for him, and he had to lay me off, and I found another job. But for the first 2 years working for him, things were great. He got me back on my feet, and I was able to get my driver's license back, and things turned around for me.
So citizens at work, not a federal initiative.
And it happens. There are good people out there that will give guys like Chris a chance when they come out. One of the problems we have, though, is we've never really gone out and told people that people like Chris are coming out of the prison and are going to be in need of jobs. They're hardworking. They've made some mistakes in their life. They're ready to make that change. They've got to be given these opportunities. Otherwise, like Chris said, because of the lack of money, they're going to go right back to their old ways again. And that's what leads to the recidivism back to the prison. You know, if we can provide some information to employers out there to help in these cases with people like Chris, and to tell them that there are certain benefits actually with hiring somebody coming out of the prison. You know, one benefit that I tell employers all the time is the fact that you have a probation parole officer that's assigned to this individual, and if they don't show up at work, you can call that probation parole officer and they'll be right on you, right, Chris?
Right. Oh, yeah.
So, you know, I mean, that's a good benefit. But, you know, I talk about these issues when I speak before civic groups and all that, and I actually do have people come up and say, you know what, I think I could offer a job, you know, to somebody that's coming out of prison and give somebody a chance now that I've heard you speak. And I think we just need to get the message out.
And to add that a little bit, just a little quick little scenario. When I was in the halfway house and I was working at the warehouse I was in, you actually found the inmates to work a little bit harder than the regular people, because, you know, the regular people were like, oh, you know, screw this, you know, this and that. But we're coming from, you know, look what we lost. And now we have this opportunity to work. And it just, they had a little bit more drive, I saw.
Boy, harder working, more polite, what's not to like here?
You know, one of the things that I think is important to know and to recognize, and Chris's story is remarkable, but a substantial percentage of people, both in the women's prison, by the way, where the gross percentage is higher, and in the men's prison, suffer from some mental health problem and or a substance abuse problem. It's in some ways not a surprise that people with those issues aggregate in the state prison because they're dealing with those issues. Chris has obviously dealt with it very successfully. But when people leave, often they need some help. And if you go out into the community where people tend to do best with substance problems or mental health problems, if they get the help. And so community mental health centers, which used to be very vibrant in our state, we used to be number one in the United States in the late 80s, in mental health. We're now at 37th in the nation. And so if we don't spend it there, we spend it in jails and prisons. We spend it on the human side. And
we end up spending more, too, don't we?
Yes, we do. And the other thing I think is important, this whole argument, that's why it's valuable Chris is here with a real face and a real successful story, but it oftentimes gets reduced to statistics. These are real people who want what everyone else wants, who may have problems that some of us don't have. And for everyone like Chris, there are a lot of people who love Chris, who want him to succeed, who suffer when he was suffering. So you save Chris's life with his strong input. You save a lot of other lives, too. And at the same time, we will save money. It seems counterintuitive, but it's true.
What turned it around for you?
Just not wanting to be at the place that I was at. Not wanting to feel that loneliness, that the emptiness that I was feeling at midnight in a 6x8 jail cell, you know? just wanting to feel part of again, you know?
You know, Richard, Justice Broderick raises a very good point when we're talking about this discussion. When we do look at our statistics, you know, 80 to 85% of those that come into the prison have some level of a substance abuse problem, whether it's addiction, abuse, or just use of alcohol or drugs. About 25% of that 85% have a true addiction when it comes to that we have to deal with. Then on the other side, we have about 65% that have some level of mental illness, and back about 25 to 30% a debilitating mental illness that we have to deal with. And a lot of what we're talking about, whether it be on the substance abuse or the mental health side, they're together because they're co-occurring. You have that person that suffers from mental illness that are using alcohol and drugs to self-medicate. So we're not only dealing with the mental health issue, we're also dealing with the addiction issue as well.
It almost seems like a lot of cases should go to what the state has only barely experimented with, and of course I'm referring to the mental health courts. Right. They're scattered around the state a little bit, but it's very much a very low or no cost operation where they're sort of assembling the court operation from spare parts.
We have about 8 or 9 or 10 of those. They're for nonviolent offenders. They are time intensive. I mean, that's the downside. They have a pretty good success rate, at least as of today. But I think we'll never get where we need to go in corrections with reduction of recidivism until we do what the commissioner suggests, which is to focus on the population and to treat what's there. I mean, some of the folks there are like Ozzie and Harriet's kids. They're fine, they just acted up. But some people have a substance problem, a mental health problem, or both, that may have driven their conduct. It doesn't excuse it, but it explains it. And so the only mistake we can make is to ignore it and build larger and larger prisons. There are more people right now, Richard, in the United States in jails and prisons with mental health problems than there are in mental health facilities. I mean, not a surprise we're having a problem.
Well, what do you think about one of the new tools within the law, which is the immediate and swift sanctions violation? They don't end up back in prison, but they could be all of a sudden this weekend you're back in jail or something along that line. The downside I've heard is that, you know, there goes your right of appeal. But everybody does have to buy into that. Do you expect that to be a success?
We do, and that's based on some actual results that they're getting across the country in using programs very similar to what we're talking about using here. In Hawaii, they have what's called the HOPE program. I know they're using programs in Georgia, and they're getting very, very good results. And it's because of that connection between the swift and certain sanction and the behavior. You know, quite often, you know, somebody violates the terms of their probation now, it might be months before they get before the judge. Well, there's no real connection then to the behavior. You know, now it's just, you know, a penalty. And quite often we found that two-thirds of those that come before the courts of that time were just put back on a probation again. What we want to try to do is make a difference and try to change the behavior. And we think in this particular case, we're going to have a good chance at doing that with this new system.
As we saw in the opening piece, Gary Dennis from the Federal Bureau of Justice Reinvestment said that the Department of Justice at the federal level is turning away from the punitive incarceration policies of the past, and that this is a reflection of that. Would you agree with that conclusion?
I would agree to it. This whole system that we have designed under the Justice Reinvestment Act is built on some key assumptions that we made, and we think that they're very, very important.
So not just punishment anymore.
Not just punishment anymore. It's managing offenders safely and effectively in the community.
Chief, this is all part of your philosophy of the law, too.
Well, I tell you, I think Chris would tell you this. Even though we're moving away from a strict punishment model, at least that's the idea, there's no happy day in the state prison. Take away someone's freedom and put them in a 6x8 cell, they consider that to be pretty high punishment. But I think what the commissioner is saying is it can't begin and end there. Or we're going to continue to pay for the failures, and then we're going to continue to pay to build larger and larger jails and prisons. It's a model that's broken. Richard, if 53% of our products came back 3 years later as defective, we couldn't sell stock in that company. And that's what's happening with recidivism. Guys like Chris who want to get their lives started, it's in our interest to help him do that.
We are just about out of time, so briefly from each of you, your biggest hope for this act, this new law?
That we're successful in cutting our recidivism and providing a level of success for those who are leaving the prison.
Chief?
That we don't turn back because of political pressure from those who would say this is a weak kind of crime methodology. It's not that at all.
And Chris, what's your hope?
To give these people a chance. You know, reach out your hand and don't just give up on them. You know, they still are a part of our community. Just because they're in prison doesn't mean they just disappear. They're like you guys have said tonight, you know, 90% of those people are going to be out, and they're going to be a part of the society.
As you have amply shown, I thank all of you. Commissioner Wrenn, Chris Kuntz, Chief Justice Broderick, thank you all. We'll see you next time on New Hampshire Outlook. I'm Richard Egger.